I'm Valerie Landry. This is the Sanford House Inn and Spa. We are sitting in the Van Gogh Bar and Lounge area right now. This is off hours of the restaurant, but we're getting ready for another busy day.
And I know there's a whole story here because this is a family business. So I want you to start at the beginning and tell me who was the original entrepreneur here.
Sure. It started with my grandparents. This was originally a retirement project for them. They used to own a motel in Nebraska called the Triangle Motel.
Oh, wow.
And it was in North Platte, Nebraska. And that's part of where my mom grew up. As time went on, you know, they had different careers. My grandpa worked in construction for a long time. My grandma was a nurse and worked in the medical field for a long time as well. And my mom went through school, became a doctor, moved down to Arlington, and my grandmother helped her with her practice for a long time. When it was time for my grandparents, they wanted to retire, but not totally retire. They thought about getting back into hospitality, and so the Sanford House was born. There was nothing in this area. This plot of land was vacant except for some big pecan trees. So we built it from the foundation up in the mid-90s, and my grandparents actually used to live here, and these were their quarters that they stayed in at the time. And the lounge area was actually one of our original 8 overnight rooms. It was our handicap accessible room. It's also the room my sisters and I got to stay in when we visited our grandparents. And, you know, as time went on, my grandparents realized they weren't retired anymore. They were working a lot. Mm-hmm. And so they fully retired. My mom is still doing her practice full time, and so had some different managers come through. And when I graduated college, I had the opportunity to come home and work for my family. And here I am.
That's really a great story. Your mom's a very successful doctor here in Arlington. And so this filled a very specific sort of niche in the market, right?
Yes.
Because this is a very special operating hotel, the way that you pay attention to detail and, you know, cater to the discerning traveler. But then you also have a very popular restaurant.
Yeah.
So it's interesting because I stayed here when I first came to Arlington and it fooled me. I thought it was an old house.
Yeah.
Can you tell a little bit about the physical house? You mentioned that it evolved. This used to be apartments, basically, which was a very traditional way to run an old small hotel.
Mm-hmm. Yes, definitely. And it worked really well for my grandparents for a long time to live here. But it's been something that we've kind of molded to be what we've needed it to be as the business has changed a bit more. I would say when we originally started, we were a much more traditional bed and breakfast. You know, my grandma would cook breakfast for everyone. Everyone sat at a big table in the dining room together. Our parlor space was a genuine parlor. It had couches where guests could relax in front of the fireplace and read the paper or read a book and just enjoy that time together. And then, you know, we started kind of getting into some events. We had our courtyard now that was all grass at the time with just a couple of gazebos. To look at old pictures is really hysterical to see the natural boundaries of the property and how it expanded. So we officially opened in 1997. The house was built in 95 and 96, so it has all the modern amenities that you could need. So that was a good thing. It's not like it was an old house that we had to redo plumbing or repaint mm-hmm. to get rid of lead paint or deal with asbestos or anything. We were very lucky in that end. So then as time went on, we acquired buildings for our cottage suites. For our villa suites, we built what is now the Renoir room. We built that from the foundation up, originally around our pool that we ended up filling in long term. The spa was added to the property in 2000. And probably the most recent addition to the property was a few years ago when we were able to get our parking lot, which was very exciting, even though it's a parking lot.
So you grew up as a kid. Mm-hmm. This was your grandparents' house, basically.
Yeah.
And they had visitors all the time.
We just got used. I mean, we helped. We worked. Yes. I've pulled weeds. I made beds. I cleaned bathrooms.
I'm sure.
You know, I ironed a lot, did a lot of laundry.
Sure. It was a way of life.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
The innkeeper. And so many people in my life say, oh, I want to operate a bed and breakfast. And I bet you hear that from people all the time.
So I went to school in New York. I got my degree in marketing.
Okay.
I actually did not have any intentions of coming home. I thought, I made it. I'm in New York. I'm in the big city. See you later. And then I graduated in 2008 when the economy went down. I had had some opportunities to stay there, but you know, cost of living was really hard. All of my friends were going to go back and live with their parents. The governor of New York at the time spoke at my commencement and told everyone, go home and live with your parents, which my dad is still a little angry about. And my mom called and said, Val, we really could use you. It was a time of transition here. I thought, okay, well, I'll come back and I'll do that for a little bit. We'll just kind of ride this out, see what's going to happen next. And it stuck. You know, I found my niche. I had the opportunity. I started originally as the spa director and I did our marketing, which was really fun. I discovered I had autonomy that I wouldn't really have ever gotten anywhere else. Mm-hmm. I had an opportunity to affect the change of the business. And I learned kind of how to work with family. I think I'm still learning that. That's just going to be one of those things all the time. It is my family's. It's very personal, but it is business at the same time. So balancing that is a everyday position that we find ourselves in. And then I got my MBA from UT Arlington. And I worked full-time at the same time as earning that degree and loved that experience, learned so much from that. And I found it to be really rewarding to have gotten part of my education locally here in our community. You know, we've seen a lot of changes, obviously, since that time, and our business has continued to grow, which is really great. We survived COVID so far, and, you know, it's been a really good journey so far for me professionally, because I've had an opportunity to develop a lot of different skills in different arenas, because we are still a small business. You wear all the hats. So everything from accounting to still helping clean rooms to working the front desk at the spa to doing different things. That's all in a day's work.
How large is your staff here?
In total, including part-time staff, we have around 30 to 35 employees. We do staff up for special events and things like that, or busy times we'll hire some seasonal staff. But usually on average, 30 to 35 employees.
Let's talk a little bit about how COVID has impacted you. We know the hospitality industry was hit particularly hard, possibly. But can you talk specifically about what has happened here in the last year and some of the things you've had to do to keep you and your guests safe?
COVID was not easy for anyone. And when it first started, we had just made some big changes in how we were doing our business so that we could step forward into 2020 new and refreshed. And then the rug came out from under our feet. And we thought, oh my gosh, what do we do? What is our next step? How can we manage to survive this? We did qualify for the PPP funding, and that allowed us to be able to keep our management staff, but it was really hard to look every single one of my employees in the face and tell them we couldn't employ them, and we didn't know if we'd ever be able to again.
Those were the tough decisions of small business owners.
Yeah, it was really tough. You know, we worked with our HR consultant, told everybody, you know, file for unemployment, do everything you can. We'll, as soon as we're able to do anything, we will let you know. So we were essentially closed for a couple of months, totally, which was in a time that I decided we can either throw our hands up in the air and run around and freak out, or we could look at this as an opportunity to make ourselves better. We had some time now. We could do repairs that we had never had time to do because everybody was too busy. We remodeled all of the bathrooms upstairs. We added glass panels for the showers and repainted a lot. We painted the entire building. We redid our branding. I started formulating our mission and our vision again, just to repurpose ourselves and to say, you know, gosh, this is maybe a really unique opportunity that when we come out of COVID, when we come out of this pandemic, we can be still the Sanford House, still the place our guests love and enjoy coming to, but maybe a more efficient version, maybe a leaner version. We could be something that, just because we always did it one way, we're not going to continue to do it that way.
Sure.
And it opened up the door to a lot of new ideas, a lot of just concepts that we had never really thought of before. And it's been really exciting to think through those opportunities. You know, as Arlington, as Texas started to open up, that was a huge boon for our business. And just even being able to incorporate our courtyard more in the restaurant and provide people outside dining that we hadn't really ever done before, which is so silly. We thought, it, you know, in our heads it was an event space, but why couldn't it be a restaurant space as well? Mm-hmm. That's been highly successful, and especially as you see flare-ups of COVID, mm-hmm. it's nice to know we can handle it. We can still provide you a clean, safe environment to enjoy your time with other people and make sure that you are taking care of you and you have an opportunity to escape your house for a little bit, mm-hmm. and be outdoors, but somewhere where you can totally relax and know you're in good hands.
And your outdoor patio is probably one of the biggest outdoor patios in all of Arlington. So it becomes a game changer then in mm-hmm. this environment when it comes to staging weddings and community events. We had our annual meeting on your patio, and tell me about what we're gonna do here on October the 3rd.
We're very excited for this, our gospel brunch. So our team is really excited to have the opportunity to showcase our property in a way it's never really been showcased before. We've certainly done live music. We used to have jazz in the courtyard pretty regularly, but this is a really unique event in that the talent that's coming, the gospel itself, I think the passion that's gonna come from that performance is really great. It's such a unique opportunity to be able to provide brunch in such an elevated setting and allow the guests who do buy those tickets to get something that they have never experienced before. And we have never experienced it before either. So it's gonna be fun for all of us to really make this event so special. And just something that is kind of a once in a lifetime right now. It can hopefully be a repeat in the future.
And this gospel brunch, it's part of the Rambling Roads Music Festival, yes. The new weekend of live music. This particular ticket actually is our hottest ticket right now.
Oh, cool.
We expect the gospel brunch will sell out.
Wow.
So get ready.
Okay, we're ready.
Chef, get ready. Then we have some very amazing guest artists coming.
Yeah.
But it's the Franklin Imagine Group mm-hmm. that is putting the whole choral presentation together. And I think it's going to really be special. And the Gospel Brunch is being sponsored by Graham & Associates and the Nehemiah Group.
Oh, wonderful.
Together. So,
great.
Yeah, we really appreciate the collaboration and the partnership.
Yeah.
You're a big believer in collaboration.
Yes.
You work with a lot of local businesses. Can you talk about some of your successful collaborations and partnerships?
So some are ongoing, like we do our yoga and brunch with the Arlington Yoga Center. Some are just one-offs every now and again. But I think that's one of the things that I try really hard to honor. And that's something that has been instilled in me, I think, from the community, from seeing the benefits of partnership and being a part of organizations like Downtown Arlington, like the Chamber, meeting different professionals, seeing what their business does and how good they are at what they do. To me, I find that really inspiring. And I instantly try to think, oh, how can we partner together? How can we highlight what you do and how good you are at that? And my property can give you the backdrop for that. So let's partner. Let's show what everyone can do really well. And, you know, I like to keep it in Arlington. I think that's an important thing. And that's certainly something you see pretty consistently, I think, throughout the leadership of our city. I think the way the organizations really bond well together is really important.
And it's special because it doesn't work that way in other cities.
No, it doesn't. So. I think people get really siloed, and it's neat to sit in a room and brainstorm and think, okay, this is what we're thinking of.
And you're part of something bigger.
Yeah.
You know, you've seen so much change. So you grew up here. Mm-hmm. Arlington was a certain way. You went away to college. You came back. Mm-hmm. You've stepped into and taken this business to the next level. But can you talk about the changes in downtown Arlington all around you?
Oh, man. There's been so many. I don't know that there's I've had an answer. I think the biggest change I am most excited about is just the genuine love for our city that you see and people wanting to invest in the place they grew up in the place they raised their children in. They want to be here and they have unique ideas, and they also want to show other people why Arlington is so great and what there is to do here. I think you see collaborative efforts like Urban Union, you see things going forward where there's like a really legitimate coffee scene happening mm-hmm. downtown. There are just cool pockets of entertainment with the Levitt Pavilion, with all of the bands that happen at Legal Draft or Division Brewing. There's just so many cool things happening. It's exciting to tell my guests, oh man, there's so many things to do here now. And to be able to go to games and concerts and be a special part of that experience for these guests is really just incredible. Whenever they had the Chris Stapleton concert, we had a whole bunch of people in for that, which was so fun. And just to see people dressed up for a special event again has been really amazing. You don't realize how much you miss it yes. until it comes back and you get to see it and be in it and, you know, just help them celebrate that yeah. special moment is really cool.
Well, we can tell that's your real spirit of hospitality. It comes through.
Yeah, thank you.
So you're a working mom. Mm-hmm. You are a leader in the community. You provide a lot of service. I know you served on our board and led our board for a couple of years.
Yeah.
How do you keep all that balance?
Ooh, I don't know that I would say I have a balance. You know, I have a lot of support. My family's here. I have a phenomenal husband who really loves to be a dad, and he's a great dad, and so I have that help. At the Women's Alliance luncheon a couple years ago when the Shunda spoke, and she said, in your personal life, you need to have a diversified portfolio.
I remember that.
And she said, I thought it was so powerful, and it really stuck with me because it said, you cannot be 100% of everything 100% of the time. But when you're in that moment, when you're in that mom moment, when you're in that work moment, mm-hmm. be 100% there. Mm-hmm. So that really, I think, helped me give myself a break a little
sure.
bit.
Sure.
But yeah, I mean, I think I'm very blessed in that both my family and my husband's family are local and that they're all here to support us and help my girls and make sure they know that they're loved. And, you know, they get to come here a lot, too. They love coming to the Sanford House. And so
who knows? Maybe in another 25 years, they can step into your shoes.
Maybe. But they love to run around the courtyard, and they're used to being on the property and seeing things. And that part's so nice.
That's full circle. Mm-hmm. That's really cool.
It is really cool. But, yeah, you just got to be 100% in that moment that you're in.
I had a chance to watch Kurt Franklin be interviewed when he was doing Camp Lotus a couple yeah. years ago, and he said something that has stuck with me. He said, we're not human doings, we're human beings.
Yeah.
And don't let your work define you too much.
Huge.
So,
I think that's a really important part, and something that I'm still working on and learning. I think everybody is to some
yes.
degree because, you know, that was one of the boons of having to go through the pandemic for me, and I have mixed emotions about saying it because it was such a hard time for the world, but it was a respite I desperately needed at that time, and it allowed me to really try and step back and focus on what are the things that are most important to me.
Yes.
What are the things I want to really devote my energy to? And what are the next steps? Where what is the long-term goal? Where do we want to be? Who do we want to be when we grow up? What does that look like? And it can always change and evolve and grow, and I think that's so special.
And that's got to be one of the hallmarks of being an entrepreneur is adapting and
yeah.
changing. The pandemic has taught us all that.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think are the keys to entrepreneurship, having grown up in a family of entrepreneurs?
Have courage. You have to be brave, and you have to have a lot of belief in yourself and in the value you're providing. But you have to be super creative and steadfast. You can't let little things knock you off kilter. You cannot let naysayers get to you. You have to develop really thick skin, I think. Even the naysayers in your own head sometimes. You have to
yes.
get through those and get through doubt and just know, you know, find that core value and stick to it. Because if you get too wishy-washy, if you go through too many different iterations of something, it starts to be washed out. And you should always live with brightness and passion, I think. And that is crucial to success long-term for anyone. I think it's finding what it is that makes you the most passionate. And, you know, my team does a great job here. And I think one of the things we're most passionate about is caring. We're most passionate about welcoming people. We're most passionate about making sure our guests feel at ease, at peace. I think that's really huge.
Yeah, and you feel that when you walk in here.
Good.
It's a very special place. Yeah. Well, we're so fortunate that you're part of downtown.
Yeah.
And I want to see the next generation be here for a long, long time.
Yeah, we'll see. You know, we love being in Arlington. This is a community that has, you know, really accepted my family and me. And it's fun to see how the city is still growing and changing and evolving and developing. And I'm excited for the future. There's a lot there.
And there's lots of opportunities for people to be a part of it.
So much. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us today for our Down to Business podcast series. We were here at the beautiful Sanford House Inn and Spa in downtown Arlington with Valerie Landry and her family of innkeepers. We hope you'll join us every other week on Facebook Live. We air on Wednesday afternoon, so see you next time.